Good day to you all. This video contains the narrated presentation of the keynote I gave at the Enterprise Architecture Conference Europe, October 2018, with a few changes and additions. Listening to this narrated presentation is not as lively as the real thing, but I'll do my best to keep you entertained. The next slides are about me, and I will not talk about myself during presentations. These slides are here in case you want to pause the presentation and read them. Let's move on to the subject of today, architecture in an age of agile. We are going to start by revisiting the idea of the architecture of the organization. For me, that is about its landscape that consists of people and their behavior on the one side, and IT and its behavior on the other. I call that the business-IT landscape, so not just IT. Now, why do we need architecture? Well, while it is about people and IT, the fundamental reason we need architecture is the growth of IT. Thanks to digital computing, storage and networking, humankind has, over the last 60 years, built an enormous amount of digital logic and digital data. We enterprise architects are used to looking at the organization scale, but take a few seconds and try to look at it from the world's perspective. This logic and the digital data it requires has become huge, and it has a couple of important properties. First, it is volatile. It changes all the time. This is fundamentally because that logic is mostly software, but even the hardware doesn't have a very long lifespan. Second, it is brittle. Logic by nature is brittle. It is very sensitive to inputs, and you cannot change a part without influencing the whole. Third, it is complex. That has to do with the growth of volume and the fact that there are many, many interrelations between the parts. This means that, as far as I'm concerned, we should forget the soothing idea that enterprise architecture is not about IT. What we need to manage with architecture is the volatility, the brittleness, and the complexity of all that logic. And that logic is almost entirely IT. Therefore, the main goals for architecture for me are a fight against the results of that volatility, brittleness, and complexity. So architecture is about robustness, efficiency, and flexibility. Next to the obvious bugs in systems, robustness mostly means security and continuity. Efficiency means the cost of using all that logic and data, and flexibility is about the problems we face when we try to make changes in all that logic. You might wonder, what about alignment? Aren't we supposed to focus on business value and make sure the IT supports our business strategy and goals? The answer is yes. But first, it's the business that defines the value. And second, business demands change much faster than the core landscape can change. The average lifespan of a business strategy is about 4 years. The average lifespan of a core element or design decision in your landscape may be around 15 years. Alignment mostly means being flexible enough so you can follow the business at a reasonable expense. It runs in the other direction as well. New technology makes the business change. My approach to enterprise architecture is based on the experience that for effective architecture, you need to do things quite different from the ways proposed by the orthodox so-called best practices. I think, by the way, that the term best practice is one of the most misused terms in our field. Treat it with caution when you encounter it. It might be best for someone else, not for you. My 2016 Enterprise Architecture Conference keynote is also on YouTube, on my YouTube channel. You can have a look at it if you want the full story. Here I'm going to summarize it in one page. As said, Chess and the Art of Enterprise Architecture explains why orthodox approaches to enterprise architecture have very fundamental flaws that make it most likely impossible for it to work as expected. In short, enterprise architecture chess is an approach to enterprise architecture that has analogies with playing chess. Content-wise, in enterprise architecture chess, we constantly try to strengthen our current position instead of working towards some defined future state. Instead of working with a future state, we work explicitly on the basis of the uncertainties of the future. We do not use architecture principles as they have toxic side effects and do not really lead to the best solutions. We do not ignore details. Sometimes the position of a pawn wins or loses you the game. Process-wise, we manage the checks and balances between the specific solutions and the overall landscape. And we do that by running a consent-based, which means I can live with it, collaborative design process for the enterprise. We marshal the knowledge of the organization to make the best design decisions. You could say it is a pragmatic, agile approach to doing enterprise architecture. No waterfall, no defined future state, but anchored in the here and now, and guiding the organization when it rides the waves of constant change. That is quite different from the old school enterprise architect. That person was supposed to translate the organization's strategy to a desired future state landscape and define the program of changes to get there. But such a waterfall-like approach never worked at all. And as our world gets more complex and volatile, it has no chance in hell to ever work. This is why my private definition of an old-school enterprise architect is an intelligent designer in a world of overwhelming complexity, but without the godlike powers to back that up. Classically, the role of the enterprise architect has been an impossible one. It never could work to solve the issues it was meant to resolve. And the people who claimed the role in practice suggested they could work miracles. They could not, so no wonder the stakeholders have largely been very dissatisfied. Enterprise architecture chess fixes that, by the way, though my experience also has not been one big shiny success. Back to architecture. What is architecture? Well, according to the principles of the Agile Manifesto, it is this. Of course, it doesn't really say what architecture is, doesn't it? It only says where it is coming from. Well, you know this one probably. It's a definite what. But what, quote, fundamental concepts and properties, quote, are, is nowhere defined. Actually, this was originally a definition for software architecture. And by the way, the agile idea of emerging from teams shows the same software focus. And of course, you will remember that I really think that architecture principles are suspect, to say the least. The last part also shows that the idea behind architecture here is a planning process. Let's move to what some other people have said. Here is Grady Booch, one of the influential software engineering gurus. He said that architecture is design. And I agree, by the way. He said it is the significant design decisions. And other than ISO, he actually tells us what significant is. Whatever is costly to change. He's not the only one. Martin Fowler, another software engineering guru and one of the authors of the Agile Manifesto, has said the same. Namely, architecture is things that are hard to change. So, again, what is architecture? Well, every landscape has a design and it's generally a mix of emerging and intentional design. Often the intentional design choices in solutions end up being emergent design choices elsewhere in the enterprise. But what does hard to change actually mean? Well, firstly, design is only hard to change when it has been implemented, right? Now, I've been in architecture design decisions that, because of the complexity of the problem, took half a year to finish. But generally, a design choice is theoretically easy to change. It's this paper. Implemented design choice is far less so easy to change. And let's recall that it is easy for IT, software mostly, to ignore prescriptive choices that have been made. Suppose your design prescription is to run everything on Oracle databases. It's however easy for a single PostgreSQL database to appear here or there. That's not hard. But it is hard to change all Oracle to PostgreSQL. In a landscape, in an architecture, small aberrations, bits of IT dirt, or small holes can accumulate. Each by itself is not hard to change, but the total can be hard to change. So that leads us to the following definition of architecture. Now, I hate wasting my time with definitions, but sometimes they help, and this one has really helped me. Architecture is the design decisions that are hard to completely remove from implementations. This definition has advantages and disadvantages. One disadvantage is that the concept of architecture has become volatile. It depends on the implementation, on what really is there in your landscape. And it also becomes otherwise volatile as you can actually remove architecture. By making something easy to change, it becomes just a feature, not architecture. In fact, Martin Fowler tells us that the architect doesn't just create architecture. The most important task he sees is to remove it. Wait, what? But that makes sense. After all, if you add a lot of functionality that makes matters easy to adapt in one sense, the way you have created that flexibility itself is probably less easy to change. So see, you see the recursion. Okay, let's rest our case here and move over to Agile. What is Agile? Well, it's good to understand where Agile comes from. Agile comes from an uprising of unhappy programmers. Programmers who are intelligent and creative people were being managed in a way that it hurt their productivity, which is a key to programmer job satisfaction. Their world is the world of silly putty bits of logic, a world where change is not just easy, it is what makes the world wonderful to work in. For you who, like me, come from software engineering backgrounds, you will know what I mean. For those who come from a non-technical background, such as business administration, it is important that you understand. One of the origins of Agile was extreme programming. And in the words of one of the originators, it was meant to make the world a good place for programmers. The programmers' motivation was hurting from the fact that they were working in settings where they constantly could see how things could be better, and with less bureaucracy, amongst others from old school enterprise architects' mind, but were not allowed to make things better. The programmers that created extreme programming and the Agile Manifesto created a setup where they have maximum freedom to be creative and productive. And the essence is, you give a team a vision, let them hash out code as quickly as they can, constantly producing iterations, and let the users interact all the time. No bureaucracy or big upfront design, but a flexible interactive setup. It is a programmer's wet dream, but in part also a user's wet dream, because the user's experiences weren't that good either. Long waits and too few results. It is all based on the earlier mentioned core aspect of IT, the softness of software elements. But there is one big problem with Agile. It does not really scale easily. And there is also another problem. It works best in settings where you build everything yourself. Again, that is the programmer's perspective. But what if you buy and integrate? There are large parts you have no control over, severely limiting your influence. This snippet was used by Martin Fowler in an article, and it shows three things about the world of programs. First, the core beauty of software. Nothing seems or feels impossible. This is the core attraction of the discipline. There is, I must say, a bit of ignorance is bliss here. Some programmers tend to ignore the real world, living in that pure and perfect logical world they want to inhabit. It is one of the most common weaknesses of programmers. It has led, for instance, to the totally broken concept of non-functionals. But don't get me started on that one. Second, making a single part easy to change is easy, but it is impossible to make everything easy to change. And there lies the rub. If you look back at the last 60 years and the enormous growth of the logical landscape, you see a pattern. Every time matters get so complex that we humans struggle to make it robust or efficient or flexible, we invent abstractions and automation that makes the complex again manageable for us humans. And then we do not take the rest of the year off. No, we fill the capacity we just created with extra volume and functionality until, again, the human limit to manage complexity is reached. This is such a constant that I have christened it the law of complexity capacity exhaustion. Early in my career, I did some programming work for a university hospital, and they told me what happened in the years before. they used to be able to do only 2 statistical research projects per year at that department. The reason was that they had to collect all the data on paper, then had human calculators who calculated the statistics. It was enormously time-consuming. So when they computerized the patient records, statistical research results that used to take half a year to get now were ready in a few days of modeling and calculating. So they expected that they would free up a lot of time to spend on other research and patients and so forth. But what happened was that instead of 2 such calculations, they did maybe 100 times as many. And that produced its own problem, how to handle all these results. That is more or less in a nutshell what has been going on for 60 years now. We constantly maximize the use of IT logic to our human limits. Okay, back to Agile. Agile handles complexity by creating freedom at the lowest levels of the organization. It has been inspired by Lean, which comes from Toyota's manufacturing improvements. In a way, Agile is the waterfall methods of IT change what the Toyota system was to the Taylor/Ford way of manufacturing. The Taylor/Ford model tries to improve productivity by a strict top-down, upfront design that makes sure everything fits. The Toyota system creates flexibility in each part of the factory and creates thus elements of local design. However, and that is a big however, people tend to forget that the Toyota system was based on strict limitations on variability and freedom. It was a sub-optimization in a setting with very specific characteristics. Agile has some notable weak spots. First, it doesn't scale well. Too much Agile can actually make you less Agile. Agile doesn't give you an infinite change capacity, nor an infinite flexibility in planning and prioritizing. Second, the idea that good architecture emerges automatically is frightfully naive. Third, the idea that everything can be decomposed in easy bits that can be tackled independently is likewise naive. The reality of the world isn't like that at all. Fourth, Agile, in practice, strongly depends on teams being excellent. Now, the guys who invented it were all excellent programmers. But in the real world, teams are on average made up, you should not be surprised, average programmers. We run the risk of using a supercar with an experienced or poor drivers in our team. Fifth, people tend to forget that refactoring by a team is meant to be invisible to the environment of a team. In real IT landscapes, this is often not feasible. Agile and architecture are in the same boat, so to say. Classic ideas, such as the IBM Business Systems programming-derived ideas for enterprise architecture and the Agile Manifesto-derived ideas for Agile, are both naive. The Agile world is, however, rapidly maturing. This might come from its inherently pragmatic and Agile basis. After all, if you can't change Agile, it's not really Agile, is it? So we end up with a large and complex framework such as SAFe to let Agile scale. A world full of Agile consultants, coaches, and so forth. Or what Martin Fowler calls the Agile Industrial Complex. Not that different from the enterprise architecture industrial complex, mind. And what we also see is Agile gone wrong in several ways, from dark scrum, with another generation of very unhappy programmers, to organizations that have disintegrated in a fragmented landscape of silos. Oops. Agile has become very popular. Everyone and their grandmother are doing it. It's also hard to do well, and it's perfectly possible for Agile approaches to fail utterly. Still, many organizations jump on the Agile bandwagon because they believe it is helping. And I think it is. It is hard to make statements about project failures, if only because it is so hard to define what you are talking about. So we know that Agile is not a certain road to success, but it could very well be that its failure rate is substantially lower than classic waterfall-oriented project planning-based delivery. Just a small note, there were quite a few methodological weak spots in the papers that are quoted on this slide. But even if 20% of Agile transformations fail, it can still be considered a huge success. We don't know yet. Maybe Agile will not really impact the way we constantly work at the edge of the manageable. Maybe it will, but the cost will be prohibitive. It looks promising, and it looks like Agile is going to be the new norm. Remember the godlike intelligent designer that is the old school enterprise architect? Well, the jury is still out, but could this be the outcome for architecture emerging from the Agile process? Let's talk about evolutionary approaches for a short while. It is important to understand that any evolutionary approach is efficient at scale but by being wasteful locally. If your organization does not accept Agile to be wasteful, for instance, if your teams are directed to do it first time right, or if the refactoring to solve architectural issues does not take place, the organization will probably do Agile in name only, a corrupted form that is more a variation of old-fashioned project management. And why do I state it is wasteful? That is related to architecture. When we are doing small scope optimizations that take place between users and programmers in a chain setting, and especially if we are following mantras like YACNI, which stands for you ain't gonna need it, which translates to only building or refactoring what is needed for the features that are required right now, you will sometimes end up in a dead end. And a large refactor that does not bring any visible value for the organization is needed. A refactor means that you are going to throw things away. And in that sense, it is wasteful. So let's merge our two paths. Agile and architecture both have their roots in the problems of large-scale programming. And the problems they want to solve are the same. The complexity that arises from software's fundamental softness, which in turn leads to problems with robustness, efficiency, and agility at a larger scale. And it's all about because the logic is brittle. The classical architecture discipline has boldly stated it was the solution for this over 30 years. It wasn't really, and all but those in denial are aware of that. The Agile discipline goes through the same, and hopefully quicker. It also has a better start, as we already know that in most cases the waterfalls are not really an option, so we won't easily go back. The enterprise chess approach to architecture mimics that, by the way. Upfront design and engineering is like the future state approach in old school enterprise architecture. Both enterprise chess and agile development share the idea that one should focus on the here and now and improve the here and now, not just dream up an end state and work towards it. In fact, we could say that agile and architecture are opposites on the same scale. When we define architecture as that what is hard to change, and Agile as change is easy, this becomes apparent. Architects in an Agile world should be busy removing as much architecture as they can. That's a twist, isn't it? Did you know that? Your task as an architect is not to create architecture, but to remove it. Anyway, we can, as far as I'm concerned, put the final nail in the coffin of classical IBM business systems programming derived approaches such as TOGAF and FIAF. Forget about them. They were illusions to start with. Funny enough, the even older Zachman ontology is perfectly usable in an agile setting, as long as it is not taken as the demand to do everything in the ontology and in a top-down planning at that. And of course, there are certainly parts of classic approaches that can be useful, such as, for instance, a repository of architectural items, such as templates, patterns, etc. But one should forget about the linear waterfall that is TOGAF's ADM, the architecture development method, for instance. Don't get fooled by the picture here. The ADM is linear. That is somehow with a lot of force has been bent to look like a cycle. So how do we manage architecture in an agile setting? Well, we need to be agile in our architecture governance too. For me, that starts with the style I have described in Chess and the Art of Enterprise Architecture. Basically, it turns key tenets of old school architecture around. For instance, architecture principles do not play a role. nor does a future state to work towards, nor is architecture strongly linked to business strategy, and it is also not high level only. Instead, it concentrates on the here and now. It has as goal to improve the current landscape, and it looks to manage the relevant details. And it does all of that in a collaborative setup focused on actual design decisions and requirements, which are made in the organization and not dumped on the organization by a central architecture function. On top of that, I have found the idea of a separate architecture backlog and the idea that it is so difficult to prioritize architecture work that the only way that really works is to set aside a fixed capacity for it. Oh, and by the way, architecture work in this is not just what the architects do. Architecture work is all the work that all the teams do that affect or create or remove architecture. After all, from what the teams do, the architecture emerges because the teams implement. You need to resist the urge to do much upfront paper design. Instead, you can design by using agile spikes. I think of architecture generally as being about three things: robustness, efficiency, and agility. Robustness is that our landscape is secure and reliable. Efficiency is that it makes us efficient, our cost of running the business is low. And agility is that we can change efficiently, our cost of change is low, while retaining our robustness and efficiency. The key aspect of any good architecture can be summed up as robustness under uncertainty. And the alignment thing? Well, that was what was a key aspect of the old school IBM business system planning derived architecture frameworks such as TOGAF and FIAF. It is of course important to keep in mind, but in the end it's a minor aspect of doing architecture, not a key aspect. Alignment is taken care of by the large scale agile that, method or not, each organization effectively always is. Change is always eternal, change is everywhere. Alignment emerges. We need to set the stage so that it can emerge best. For agile, as in the upfront design situation, we need checks and balances between the solution, or the team, and the overall landscape, or the lead enterprise architect and his or her team. We can set up architecture boards where the actual backlog items are discussed. The team technical leads take part in those boards. We can also set up lots of cross-team group conversations based on actual results. Discuss the changed architectural landscape immediately after some architecture has emerged. What we want is for design choices to continuously spill into the organization. The central architecture role, the enterprise architect, is responsible to make that happen. As we all have experienced, prioritizing architecture in practice almost never works well. We need to set up a fixed architecture capacity in the teams that is filled from the architecture backlog in collaboration between product owner and lead architect. Again, architecture is not what is done by architects only. Everything the team creates that is hard to change is architecture. A new initiative may start with 100% architecture work. But so the way to do that is generally not to write designs, but to build designs to implement them in agile spikes. In enterprise architecture chess, in the enterprise architecture chess approach, architecture is making design decisions on the hard to change elements in a consent-based collaborative approach. Those in the know discuss the issues and come up with the best choices. What is very important is the use of consent-based decision-making. Most organizations still try to work with consensus. The difference is that if you strive for consensus, you want all to agree the decision is the best decision. In a complex environment, as a modern organization, and especially the brittle, unknown, and volatile aspects of its IT, it is almost impossible to reach consensus. So either no real decision is ever taken, as consensus is not reached, or a decision is taken, but there is no consensus and you keep hidden conflict. Consent-based decision-making makes the negative effects a lot less severe. In consent-based decision-making, you agree when you can live with it. You do not need to think the decision is the best that can be taken. It is a decision that you can live with, where you think it might not be the best, but it certainly is not the worst. The effect of this is that it becomes a lot easier to make decisions. Being able to live with it is a positive attitude. I'll go along unless you are definitely wrecking our future. We still do need to have good escalation mechanisms in place when someone can't live with it. That is needed, so we know consent is exactly that, being able to live with it. And it is very important that management does not punish escalation, but sees it as a very essential outlet for good decision making. If you think about it, the key difference between consent-based and consensus-based decision making is that while both strive for consensus, the lack of it doesn't give anyone effectively a veto in consent-based decision making. In consent-based decision making, the stakeholders give up their veto in exchange for the right to start an escalation. As this is less powerful for the stakeholder, they are generally loath to give consensus-based decision making up. Also important is that when the escalation happens, in general, a decision will be taken where someone can't live with it. After escalation has produced a result, you must live with it. You must see the in your eyes bad thing that has been decided as one of the other million bad things you are aware of in your landscape and carry on. It is important that all participants are convinced the process is fair enough and therefore accept the results. Note, what SAFe calls the architectural runway for a team should be managed by that team in its own time. The architectural runway for multiple teams is managed by architecture. The work of a team still falls under architecture quality assurance. For instance, do they manage their own runway well? Or are there aspects of their own runway that in reality affect others? While putting everything, features, defects, architecture, depth in the same bucket doesn't work, using a weighted shorter job first approach for the architecture items can help. For instance, we can weigh our items with a mock Fibonacci scale on robustness, efficiency, and agility and aesthetics. And you might wonder why aesthetics was put in this example. That has to do with the fact that these numbers are, after all, illusions. And we know that aesthetics is a good proxy for good architecture. It's like in the sciences. There is art in science. Mathematicians like elegant proofs. Physicists like elegant theories. They like those for a reason. They are a reliable proxy for quality and robustness. Occam's razor is related to this conviction. It is where our non-discrete brains use their strength in non-logical but imperfectly reliable estimation over perfectly reliable but overcomplicated rationality. The weighted shortest job first approach can be extended in several ways. Suppose our organization has a decent robustness, but our problem is in efficiency and agility. We might weigh these aspects more. And compared to the previous table, suddenly another item comes up on top. Without the overall weighing, introducing better credentials management comes out on top. You see that at the bottom. But with the weighing, adding support for a platform comes out on top. Anyway, don't get carried away by these illusions of exactness. The numbers are unreliable estimates, so in the end, one question must be, can we live with this? Does it feel good overall? Again, is there consent? By using consent, we explicitly add our human type of not strictly logical intelligence to the process. Sadly, though, we cannot really trust our estimations as well. As psychological research has shown, our brains have two separately recognizable approaches. A fast system that can handle many aspects concurrently, but is sloppy, and a slow system that is limited in the amount of issues it can handle concurrently, but that is more precise. We are mostly governed by the fast system. And one of the aspects of the fast system is that it works with what it has, and that if there is something essential missing, it ignores it or uses a proxy. For instance, asset managers are prone to use proxies like, do I like the product? For, is the management of this firm okay? Which is, for an investment division, plain silly. Working with what there is called the what you see is all there is assumption. Our fast system is opportunistic and overly optimistic in terms of the positive potential but it also gives more weight to the negatives and risks. In fact, in this fast-developing information revolution, we are constantly working at the limits of our human mental capacities. The amount of logic overwhelms our logical capabilities, and has already done so since the first digital computers. And our non-rational estimation capabilities have fundamental limits of their own as well. But there is a simple instrument that can help you, and it's called a pre-mortem. Now, we all know what a post-mortem is. Some project has gone horribly wrong, and we sit together and analyze why. And we ask ourselves, how has this so horribly gone wrong? And we do that with the intent to learn and not make the same errors again. A pre-mortem is a virtual post-mortem. You take a few hours with key players and you imagine how your project can go wrong. You imagine yourself 2 to 3 years from now and you say, it is 2 years from now. The initiative has failed miserably. What went wrong? It puts your brain into system 2, looking for things you do not know, for the unknown unknowns. Out of that come risks and things you have overlooked, and these you have to manage. It is basically a good idea to run a pre-mortem every time you make an architectural decision. A decision about something that will be very hard to change when it has been implemented. Historically, we have done well with reductionism as a design approach or in science. Reductionism is also apparent in most of our architectural approaches, both in the top-down waterfalls, which tend to go in ever more detail when going down, and in Agile, which divides the world in small parts with independent teams. But there are some new approaches to design in our complex world. One such an approach is anti-fragile. It is an approach that directly attacks the brittleness of our complex world. There are interesting concepts behind anti-fragile, but it is an approach to increase robustness based on redundancy and diversity, both negatives on efficiency and in some ways flexibility. Using redundancy is pretty common in IT. We have load balancers, active-active and active-passive continuity solutions and so forth. What we generally do not use often is diversity, because diversity is costly. However, the brittle nature of logic does lead to some unintended diversity that does actually add to anti-fragility. Anyway, while anti-fragile is an interesting aspect, it is not a cure-all and there is a price to pay. Use with caution and very consciously pay the price. Okay, I will be wrapping up now. The jury on Agile is still out, but there are hopeful signs that it is able to reduce the failure rate of transformations. If that turns out to be true, we architects must embrace agility, and old-school, upfront approaches to architecture are mostly irrelevant. However, no methodology whatsoever can solve the underlying fundamental problem that as long as the amount of logic is growing so immensely, as it does now, our societies are now constantly changing at the limits of our mental capacity, and working at these limits puts us in a state of permanent exhaustion. It's probably wise to put more focus on the limits to what can be changed and at what speed. What I wanted to convey was this. We need to deeply understand this new world full of brittle automation, and that requires understanding the fundamental strengths and weaknesses of digital IT itself. The most fundamental aspect of IT to be aware of as an architect or designer is that it is brittle. The world we operate in as architects is a world where we are constantly at the limits of complexity we humans can handle. So this will remain so as long as the volume of logic in the world keeps growing. So probably for our lifetimes at least. High failure rates are natural and are not completely avoidable. Architecture and Agile are in a way each other's opposites. Not adversaries, more like two sides of the same metal. Doing architecture can be about removing architecture to make the situation more agile. Doing agile must include awareness that you are creating the hard-to-change aspects of your landscape. In other words, you are creating architecture. In an agile setting, good architecture doesn't emerge easily, let alone automatically, and it needs a good architectural process and way of working. Good architecture requires a separate, consent-based, collaborative checks and balances process to make the right design decisions for the organization. That process is not that difficult, but the content is. It is, however, hard to get to that state given how immature we all are in this field. And that process is not the old school 1960s derived classical upfront architecture approach, not even in a light form. That was it. Thank you very much.